I I'm the son of Frank Kendall and Annie Mary Martin. And I have a twin sister, Frida, and we were born March 27th, 1927. At 12, my father passed away, and our family life changed. We didn't go back to the cottage anymore, and I just went to school, and I was not a good student. I didn't really know. Joined the Air Force at 16 in 1943. And things were going well until they accepted me. And I went to London to go to Toronto and Haney Dipple. And someone hollered out, "Kendall, we have no birth certificate." I said, "It's all in that big envelope." Okay. And that was the end. The last I heard of it. So I went out to Haney Dipple. And I really couldn't believe it. Haney Dipple, the old to me at 16. Old men that were crying themselves to sleep first time away from home. They cut their hair as soon as we got there, and it was all marching here and marching there, and we slept in what they call the bullpens. And after about 8 weeks of that, I got sent to go out pre-air school, and that was at the Walk University. So I took my wireless in Walk. That was about a year. And it was a tough course. It wasn't for left-handed people because we were in cubicles. The bug, as we called it, where I was set, was on the right-hand side. So I used my left hand with the bug and then stop and write with the pencil because I couldn't see the maneuver of the code with my right hand. But anyway, we went through that. And we took the air crew, and we flew in Harvard to the Yales. And we get up in the air, put our antennas down. We had to make so many contacts in 2 hours. Well, we always had our contacts within a half an hour. So then it was just a dogfight throughout the we got out over the lake in the Yales and the Harvards. We would just make like we were in dogfights. It was just a wonderful time. I was just a happy little kid flying around in this military plane, enjoying my life. But quick was not in my vocabulary, so I struggled through and eventually got my stripes in that golf, and then I got transferred to Kendall. And that's where I graduated and got my wag wings. And that the war was pretty well coming to an end. The European war ended, so I signed up for the Pacific, and I went to Mount Hope for a refresher course. And we figured when we finish that, we'd head off to the Pacific. Before we finished the course, Mr. Truman, President Truman, dropped the atomic bomb in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and that ended World War II. So I was stationed in Mount Hope, and they were discharging everybody. So I told them, my little white lie, that I was discharged myself in Vancouver. Well, they sent me to Vancouver, so I did get a trip up Vancouver. We were there for about 10 weeks, and I came up and we got a discharge. And I managed to get my ticket back home. And then that was it. I was out of the Air Force. But going back to the beginning, my dad's three brothers, four of them went over to France, and my one brother-in-law, Randy Storkin, was killed at Vimy Ridge. And the other three came back, my one uncle Alf lost an eye. And my dad got masked, and my other uncle, he got some too. And so, in that way, we're a little wartime active. I understand my dad in France did what they call tunneling. and that was not an easy thing. I always wanted to be in that armada of thousands of planes in the sky at one time. I would think that would be the most fascinating sight in the world. But it didn't happen. I didn't see it. I could just imagine. That's just the way it is, I guess. Just was a little too young and started too late. And the war ended too early. I'm pretty glad it did. After the war, I was a Boy Scout leader. And I felt passed away in the car. I said he was a bank messenger. So anyway, the accountant said, better got a job for you. If you want a messenger, caretaker of the Imperial Bank of Canada, in Woodstock. I sold RIFs and RSPs, and that was really my golden handshake from the bank. They paid very good commission. I made very good money. I bought myself a sailboat. I sailed for 30 years. And banking became my career in the end. I did very well at it. No, I'm the last man. I'm still here, thank you. So how long am I going to stay? And I'm going to make the best of it.
Well, on behalf of Fred's family, we welcome you. We are so glad that you're here to support the family and to celebrate an amazing life. Now, if there was anyone who was going to speak at their own funeral, Fred was the guy to do it. Because as you know, Fred spoke to everyone. And I know that's a little bit unnerving in a funeral service to begin that way, but I thought it was totally appropriate. You see, Fred believed in God, and he truly believed that because of his faith in Jesus, he stepped from this earthly life into eternal life. So this afternoon, we gather to celebrate Fred Kendall's life. We gather to pray and celebrate the fact that because of his faith in Jesus, Fred is more alive than we can ever imagine. So again, a warm welcome to you. At this point, I'm going to invite the Honorable Anita Anand to come forward, our Minister of Defense and our local MP, to share a few words. And we are so grateful that you're here today.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Pastor Paul. I can't tell you how honored I am to be here with you today to speak at the service of our dear friend, Frederick Kendall, better known as Fred. And for those who knew Fred, he found solace in difficulty and fulfillment in adventure, as we have witnessed just now in that beautiful video and tribute. A moment was never spared. Fred was a private, an air gunner, and he's revered for the service to our country as a member of the Air Force in World War II. He was one of the few remaining veterans that fought in the Second World War, and his generation fought for our freedom, our peace, and our security. And at a time in the global strategic environment when we see that security under threat, the service of Fred and his fellow veterans should never be forgotten. I'd like to extend my appreciation to the Royal Canadian Legion, an organization that continues to honor and support those who sacrificed their lives for the welfare of us all and future generations. Now, to come back to Fred, Fred knew no strangers, as Pastor Paul mentioned. He was an active member in our community, and he found a friend in anyone with whom he crossed paths. And in fact, just walking in here, many of us were remarking how we were all Fred's girlfriends. Now, Fred's charm and wit was not lost on anyone, And I'll never forget Remembrance Days when he saw me. He would hold out his hand for me to come over, and we would have a really nice reunion. And I will miss that incredibly on Remembrance Day, and I'm sure all of you will. And so, Pastor Paul, your words that Fred is among us still are very comforting today, I think, to all of us. And I'll never forget, in particular, last Remembrance Day, and I was answering questions at the Legion, and Fred rode right up to the front in the bright red scooter, and he voiced his concern about the modernization of military uniforms. And I couldn't resist but to go over and give him a hug, because, you know, while I wouldn't do that in a normal press conference, Fred is special, and Fred deserved a hug for that excellent question. Now, one of the things about this job as Minister of National Defense is that you never have much time in any one place that you're at. Every place I go, it's for a very limited amount of time, and so I have a very limited amount of, unfortunately, a very limited amount of time to interact with people. And that's why I'm ever so grateful, first of all, that I could be here with you today, but second of all, that I did get to know Fred. Of everyone I am in touch with in the course of this job, I got to know Fred, and I feel so honored. I can't tell you how honored I am to be able to say that I knew Fred. And it's really his joie de vivre. And we saw it in the video, his charismatic personality, the way he touched everyone. We should never forget that. That's what makes life special. And that's what makes our friendship with Fred so special. And so as we mourn Fred's loss, it is important to remember for us all to live each day to the fullest, to honor our family and friends, and to be the best we can to everyone around us, including our loved ones. And I'd like to close by saying a thank you to all of you for welcoming me into Fred's community, for welcoming me here today, for making sure I knew that I would be welcome even if I was giving you my confirmation at the very last minute. And, you know, I can't tell you how much that means to me. And so, Fred, we will go on missing you, especially when we gather on November 11th, when we will pay tribute to your service specifically, as well as the service of all those who fought for the freedom and the democracy that we enjoy today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I have a little certificate of condolence that I would love to be able to give to the family now.
Continue our service with a worship song. Now, I know it might not be your traditional worship song, but Fred was that kind of guy. He loved new things. So this song, which is a little bit more upbeat than you'd expect at a funeral, was something that Fred would appreciate. You're welcome to, well, just you can remain seated as we worship.
Rise up and sing of the great and mighty King. You are strong when you feel weak. as his company. Shout to the father, the son, sing to the peace and the west. Jesus, sing to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Rise up with all of the truth, send and sing to broken hearts, who can know the healing God of the glorious kingdom of God. So shout to the Lord of the sun, sing to the east and the west, Jesus, sing to God. Lord of heaven and earth. We've been through fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of his name. We pull you deeper than God in you. You burn the truth on our lips. So shine to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is sacred to all, Lord of heaven and earth. As a church of love and reigns, fill this place with songs again. Of our God who reigns on high, on his grace again was blind. And shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is singing to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die.
For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. And my eyes shall behold, not another.
For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's.
For we brought nothing into the world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, even so says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. And let's pray.
O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servant Fred, being raised with Christ, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Merciful God, whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, deal graciously with Fred's family and for those who mourn. Surround them with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Again, a warm welcome to you. At this point, I'm going to share some words from Fred's son, Ken, who was unable to be here. He lives out west. He might be watching live stream, so hi, Ken, and your family. And actually, there's some family in the UK watching as well, I believe. So this is from Fred's son. I will remember Dad as the most wonderful father, grandfather, and great-grandfather, and uncle. He had many nieces and nephews. He was the last of his family of eight. He had three grandchildren, Jason, Allison, Jennifer, and great-grandchildren, Serena, Sophia, Michaela, Hayden, Skyla, Austin, and Emily. He had two sons, Wayne and Ken. His focus in life was on the kids getting an education. He had only grade 10, but succeeded in becoming a bank manager through hard work and study. He retired with Mom Lucy in Beamsville. They both volunteered for many years at the Lions Club, Albright Manor, delivering Meals on Wheels. He loved sailing from 50 Point many days on Lake Ontario. He loved travel. He enjoyed two trips to England, and with England was Ken. He loved walking, and so we visited the Dover Cliffs. When I suggested a taxi cab up the hill, he wanted to walk, and he left me in the dust. He backpacked to Australia for 3 months in his 70s. He went to Iceland and the Arctic Ocean. He walked every day, and if he fell with his walker, he just got up and carried on. One time he said he wanted to hang off the CN Tower on a bungee cord. We managed to talk him out of it. Dad was friendly with everyone he met, and he will be greatly missed by many. Goodbye, Dad. God bless. We will meet again. Ken. So Jason's going to share some thoughts too.
Hi, everyone. I'm Frederick Jason, and this is my wife, Julia, and we're two of Fred's grandkids, and these are two of his great-grandchildren, Sophia and Serena. There's a lot of family all over Canada, and even as far as England, who wish they could be here in person today, and we'd like to stand in for all of them, especially his sons, Wayne and Ken, their wives, Joanna and Candace, grandchildren, Jennifer and Allison, and great-grandchildren, Michaela and Hayden, Austin, Emily and Scott. We are all of us here today because we knew my grandfather Fred in one way or another, so I won't get into too many facts about him that you probably are already aware of. He may have told you a few things because he did like to talk. He was certainly blessed in that regard with a sharp, communicative mind, as all his many letters to government officials over the years will attest. But not only that, letters to keep in touch, thank you notes, birthday cards, and that he was always so conscientious to send. And yet, in person, he could also be a good listener, and I always found him to be a great one to ask for advice. I was lucky enough to be close with him throughout my 49 years, and I treasured having him there for all the big moments of my life. When I married Julia, he freely opened his heart and mind to her, forming a very special bond between them. He had that way of connecting with someone so quickly and honestly that is rarely seen in our times. He was married 65 years to my wonderful grandmother, Lucy. They were a formidable team and excellent parents and grandparents. He was an adventurer, joining the RCAF as soon as he could in his youth and training as a wireless air gunner, joining the fire department to help those in crisis, roaming the streets of Woodstock as a cab driver. He always did what was needed to get ahead and to provide for his family, but was always looking to do it in a way that allowed him to be busy and fulfilled. Many of you will remember his days as a mariner, out on Lake Ontario daily in his boat, and even sailing all the way to Newfoundland in 1997. I fondly remember joining him on a lot of those trips. I also remember several more trips I recently took with him. One that was just him and me in Europe, where I watched him walk the streets of Stockholm and Dusseldorf so excitedly his shoes literally fell apart on his feet. He loved cold destinations better than the hot ones, and joining him on a trip to Iceland was another highlight I'll never forget. He also spent years as a successful banker with CIBC. Such a range of life experiences was what kept him so engaged and present, I think. And he was thankfully both of those things right to the very end of his life. He did tell me he felt it was a great life. He had few regrets, and his family and friends, all of you, were his greatest treasure. On behalf of our family, I want to extend our thanks for the support of this truly wonderful church community. I know that you've been caring for him throughout his health struggles over the past years and were with him in his final days and hours. That was a great comfort and help to him and to us. Thank you. Also, for the support of the Royal Canadian Legion, who have been instrumental in providing him tangible assistance with day-to-day living, as well as the emotional support to his quality of life that made it worth living. Thank you. Many of you here helped to provide those critical things, like a ride to an appointment, a call when he wanted it, or a laugh when he needed it. We thank you so much for adding to his life. I hope to speak with some of you today and to share some more stories. We've laid out some of the memorabilia of his life to bring back those memories. My grandfather Fred lived to the age of 95. He was born in 1927. I mention it because this puts him in the final year of the generational cohort Tom Brokaw coined the greatest generation. To me, that's so very fitting. There will never be a brother like him. He was the greatest. Thank you all for coming.
Next slide there, Tom. Next slide there, Tom. We're going to say Ecclesiastes 3. I'm going to share a few thoughts from this, and if you'd like to read it with me, that would be appreciated. So let's read it together.
For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to harvest, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build up, a time to cry, and a time to laugh, a time to grieve, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace, and a time to turn away. A time to search, and a time to quit searching. A time to keep, and a time to throw away.
A time to stare, and a time to mend. A time to be quiet, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. What do people really get for all their hard work? I see the good in God's face on us all. Yet God has made everything beautiful for us all time. He has set his integrity in the heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work. From beginning to end.
Okay. You see, folks, if there's any time when your iPad is going to not work, oh, it's working now. This is the time for that. That's why you always have a backup. So imagine this. Just went black at you. Imagine this situation. A banker phones you, very appropriate, and he phones you and he says that he's got incredible news for you. He tells you that an anonymous donor who loves you very, very much has decided to deposit 86,400 pennies into your bank account each morning, starting on Monday morning. So you're really excited and you think, okay, that's $864 a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. But there's one stipulation. You have to spend the money that same day. No balance will be carried over to the next day. Each evening, the bank will cancel that sum that you failed to use. So with a big smile, you thank your banker and you hang up. Over the weekend, you begin to plan. You grab a pencil and you start figuring out 864 times 7 equals over $6,000 a week. Times 52, that's almost $315,000 a year that you have available to you if you are diligent to spend it all. $864 a day. Remember that whatever is not spent is forfeited. Well, so much for imagine. Now think about this. Every morning, someone deposits into your bank of time 86,400 seconds, which represents 1440 minutes a day, which of course equals 24 hours a day. Now you have to remember that the same stipulation applies. This amount of time for you to use each day cannot be carried over on credit for the next day. There's no such thing as a 26-hour day, although some of us wish there was. As someone has once said, life is like a coin. You can spend it any way you can, but you only spend it once. We all have the same amount of time, whether we are penniless, whether we happen to be the richest person on earth, we have exactly the same amount of time each day. And we can say that dear Fred used his time well. Think of how much time is woven into the fabric of our conversation every day. Here's a list of things that you're familiar with. What time does a meeting start? What time does it end? I don't have time. How much time will it take? Etc. On the bulletin and on the next screen, if you brought your binoculars, you can see it. You will find some words taken from the Bible. They might be familiar to some of you, especially if you're of my vintage. I call us the moderately mature. The song Turn, 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 written by Pete Seeger, was recorded by the group called The Byrds back in 1965, and the founding member, by the way, David Crosby, just passed away the other day. For you trivia buffs out there, it reached number one on Billboard's top 40 hit, stayed there for 3 weeks, becoming the biggest hit of the Byrds' career. But the lyrics, of course, were not original with Pete Seeger. They are lifted right out of the Bible from the book called Ecclesiastes, which was written about 3,000 years ago. It means teacher. And so the teacher deserves the royalties of that song. Let's just take a quick look. For everything there's a season, a time for every activity under the heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to harvest, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build up. One thing you're going to notice as the teacher is saying here is that basically life throws at us a variety of situations. There are times where we keep things. There's times when we throw away things. Times when even a little bit of destruction, as it were, is necessary. And anyone who's ever done any home renovations know how satisfying it is to get out the sledgehammer and take down that wall to make room for your dream kitchen. Or isn't it fun to get rid of those tax forms that you've been struggling with? It's an absolute relief to get rid of them. A time to love, a time to hate. Strong passions. There's room for both. We love our family and we hate prejudice, selfishness, greed, injustice in the world around us. So what you're seeing here is a slice of real life. Good and bad things. That's life. Then the teacher tells us towards the end of the passage, yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. In other words, it's a matter of timing. At the right time, things are beautiful. At the right time. But what about at the wrong time? You know, you've heard those horror stories, being at the wrong place at the wrong time. It can be absolutely disastrous. And if you've ever lived through such a time, you've experienced that life sometimes can be very unbeautiful. Life can be very painful and it can be very difficult. Or as some people have expressed to me, life sometimes sucks. Life is pointless at times. Life is hard. Life can be what some people say is really unfair. There's a time for everything. Turn, turn, turn. There's a time when things are not very good. A time to be born and a time to die. The teacher tells us that sickness, pain, and death are times that every human being must face. You can't avoid it. Because again, that is life. How do you cope with that? How can a person survive the good and the bad? The teacher reminds us, and you'll notice it says in the last couple of lines, that God has placed eternity in the human heart. And you don't even have to be a believer in God to sense there's something out there. It's what I call an eternal itch. If anyone was watching a couple of weeks ago, the football game between the Buffalo Bills and the Cincinnati Bengals and witnessed those terrifying moments when they were trying to revive through CPR one of the football players on the field, and then both teams kneeling down together, arms interlocked with each other, obviously praying for their teammate. Even if you were not a believer, you sense that there was something going on there that was very, very important. Very important. Something supernatural. Josh Allen, the Bills quarterback, said this: I'll be the first to admit, like, I haven't been that much of a devoted follower of God in my life. I have had many different beliefs and thoughts and ideas and stuff like that. But something got a hold of me there that was extremely powerful, that, you know, you just couldn't deny something was happening. It was just spiritual, he said. I was going around with my teammates saying, God is real. Everyone, no matter what perspective that you're coming from, has probably wondered if there's something more to our earthly existence. What happens to us after our time on this earth? So the teacher here tells us that life is varied. Life throws at us everything, good and bad, everything in between. Life can be curious and frustrating. Sometimes it's unfair. Life is good. Sometimes it feels bad. The question, of course, is how are we going to use our time? I think it's fair to say that everyone in this room wants to do the best that we can. Obvious, right? We want the best for our families. We want to be loved. We want security. We want to provide for those around us. And I would say again, as you've heard, Fred lived life to the fullest. But for good or bad in our lives, we still have to face that eternal question. What about after our time in our life? Now, I've been a pastor for almost 40 years, and I've witnessed some pretty intense moments in life and death. I've had the opportunity to share with people going through incredibly good times and bad times. And I can just say, for even dear Fred, just a couple of days before he passed away, I went to see him right after our service here. I went over to the hospital, and Fred knew he wasn't coming home. He told me that. He said, I'm not going home. And then I said, well, okay, we're going to pray for you. So I had some of my chrism, which it's oil. And he goes, what's that for? And I said, well, it's just another way to pray. I said, you know, they prayed for people for healing, and they also prayed for kings. And he said, I sort of look at myself more like a duke. Well, that was Fred. And so I've seen people face life and death in two totally different ways: fear, hopelessness, or courage and hope. And I'm here to tell you that Fred faced it with courage and hope, especially hope. And so here in the passage, the teacher would tell us, look to God, because God is the one who makes sense of time. So that's 3,000 years ago. Fast forward from that time, 1,000 years to another teacher. This time it's Jesus of Nazareth. And one day, Jesus is at a funeral. It's a funeral of one of his friends named Lazarus. And again, for any Bible trivia buffs here, it's found in John chapter 11 in the Gospels, and it contains the shortest verse in the Bible. It says this: Jesus wept. Kind of small, doesn't it? Death is an affront. Death sucks. But into that sad time and hopeless time, Jesus says this: I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will have life even after dying. And some people might think, well, very nice religious words, Jesus. I'm so glad you're here. But something incredible happens next. It says this in the Bible: roll a stone aside from the tomb, Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested, Lord, he's been dead for 4 days. The smell's going to be terrible. A little bit of biblical realism there, right? Jesus responded, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven. He's praying, and he says, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me. But I said it out loud for the sake of these people standing here, so they will believe that you sent me. And then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man rose up and came out, perfectly resuscitated. Although, of course, later in life, he would pass away, like all of us. Jesus delivers. Jesus does the miraculous. He backs up what he says. The teacher says, I am the resurrection and life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even after dying. And to prove this once again, he himself will be handed over to death, this time death on a cruel cross. He will suffer and he will die in full sight of his dear family, his friends, and even his enemies. He will die, and yet, 3 days later, Easter morning, he will rise from death, never to die again. An absolute shock of another kind. He is alive again. And this same Jesus promises that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have life after our life in this earth. And that, of course, is Fred Kendall's. And the amazing thing is that that can be your hope as well. You see, every time I look into the mirror, I'm looking at a person whose time is winding down. It's a reality check. And I hate to say this, but I'm looking into the eyes of people whose time is winding down too. And the big question is, what will you do with your time? So let me have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for our dear brother, Fred. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the way, the truth, the life. We might not totally understand all this stuff, but we want to believe and we want to have that assurance in our life. So what I'm going to do, next slide, Tom. Next one, please. If you feel comfortable with this, I invite you to say this prayer out loud, or you can say it in your heart if you want. No pressure here. But I'm going to pray. So let me pray. Lord Jesus, you can say it out loud if you'd like. Lord Jesus, I open my heart to you and invite you to come in. I receive by faith forgiveness through your cross and the gift of new and eternal life through your resurrection from the dead. Help me through the power of your Holy Spirit to follow you day by day as I put my whole trust in your grace and love. Thank you that the angels in heaven are rejoicing that I've turned to you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. So what I've done here is I've put together some pictures of Fred. Wonderful technology we have, eh? So, and you'll recognize some pictures here, obviously of Fred, but some of you as well. So let it rip there. One click.
My name is Frederick William Kendall.
Unending love, amazing grace.
Slide, please. And sing a hymn, Abide With Me.
Father, I praise them on the temple.
Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be
with you.
And with your spirit.
Let's approach our Heavenly Father in prayer. I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and I will invite you, if you feel comfortable, to respond with, hear our prayer. But let's begin with the Lord's prayer, which our Savior taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I invite you to pray responsively with me here. O Savior of the world, who by your cross and precious blood has redeemed us,
save us and help us, we humbly beseech you, O Lord.
Graciously look upon our afflictions, O Lord.
Pitifully behold the sorrows of our hearts.
Make your servants to be numbered with your saints.
In glory everlasting.
Let us pray, saying,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant, we pray, to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, that through the grave and gate of death we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Grant your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you in faithful obedience. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Grant of all who mourn a sure confidence in your fatherly care, that casting their grief on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy.